Welcome to Digital Asset News, to get top stories in cryptocurrency, digital assets, and break it down to bite-sized pieces. And today is another great day for the market as we continue on with this impressive bull run, starting with these three stories. So first up, Binance launches Cardano and Cosmos staking, and it sounds fantastic until you see the rates and you have to think to yourself, are these really sustainable? On top of that, we're going to take a look at the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis is taking a close look at Ethereum DeFi. And at first glance, when I took a look at this article, I thought to myself, well, this would be negative and otherwise bearish, but it is the exact opposite. And finally, of course, as I always say, news moves the market. Dogecoin spikes after Elon Musk says he bought some for his infant son. So we'll go over those three stories, but first, let's take a look at what's going on in the market. Actually, first, what I want to do is talk to you about tonight. We're going to do a live stream. And what I want to do is go over three or four different portfolios that have been sent in to me by subscribers. Just take a look at what they have and any suggestions of what I would do if it was my portfolio. I can't give any financial advice, obviously, but we'll take a look at those and we'll do a live stream. Now, we've done live streams in the past. Didn't go so well because we had to upgrade our modem and server and all that good stuff. And now, since we are not going to be running on Wi-Fi and everything is hardwired in, I think we should do a little bit better. So look for that tonight. I'll let everybody know in a notification. Hopefully YouTube will do their job and notify all the subscribers. So if you haven't subscribed, this will be the time to do that. Anyhow, let's take a look at what's going on in the market today. So again, not too bad, right? We got Bitcoin at almost 45,000. It had a pretty good run up at 48,000, but we're down a little bit. There can only be so much euphoria from Elon Musk saying he is going to buy Bitcoin. And I got to tell you, it was a genius move, not just on the fact of buying Bitcoin, how great that is, but if you saw the stock price of Bitcoin, or sorry, the stock price of Tesla, you'd notice that it was like up 5%. So just the $1.5 billion that he put into Bitcoin, which is going to go up, I think, tremendously, he also got a nice little pump in his stock prices. So I thought, man, that's like a twofer, so good for you. The same thing happened with Joe Rogan when he went over to Spotify. They offered him like $100 million plus unconfirmed. And in like that first 24 hours, their stock went up by like 10%. So you know what? If businesses see what they can do, not just with how they can actually improve with Bitcoin and the appreciation of the price, but they know that there's a lot of smart people out there, a lot of smart stockholders, they can go, wow, we can just do a double dip. We can buy Bitcoin, our cash won't be on fire, and our stock will usually go up. That's like a 1-2-3 win. Maybe we should do that. I don't know. Not financial advice to you if you're a corporation, but makes sense to me. Anyhow, Ethereum, just below the 1800 all-time high. It's not too bad. Tether, Cardano is the real story today. And we've actually covered Cardano actually a lot more than we have in the past. And there's been some great stories. First, we covered this a couple of days ago where Cardano was talking about getting a massive government contract from different countries in sub-Saharan Africa to put them onto the Cardano blockchain, decentralized finance, decentralized identification. And I mean, if you have something like this and you're taking a look at like the network effect, that is huge. So on top of that, now we're going to be talking about further staking and the actual amount of what it is. Ugh, it's going to be huge. So Cardano, if you haven't gotten aboard, I can't tell you what to do, but you might want to take a look, real hard look at that. Anyhow, XRP is up. Don't know why, but it is 8%. I don't think there's anything different. I know people have been talking to me about the SEC and what is going on, and there's been some give and take with the SEC. So maybe that lawsuit may just go down to mediation, not for sure. And if that's the case, then congratulations, XRP holders, you did it. Anyhow, Polkadot's up for 1%, Binance Coin, and we covered this yesterday. Binance Coin's a juggernaut. And the reason why it's a juggernaut is because they do so many great things for the actual exchange. So if you have a lot of Binance, their BNB coin, you can reduce your fees. You can get into a lot of different things. There's rewards programs. And then we're going to talk about staking. I mean, why wouldn't you hold Binance coin? This is one of the things that we talked about. I think it's going to be, I really can't give a price prediction on Binance coin. But I know, I mean, double is definitely within the future, definitely this year, 2021. that can't be a price prediction. Sorry. Litecoin up 11-12% for Doge. And these are really the whole big things, because Doge only went up 12% because of why? Because of news. And also, speaking of which, I'm using TradeTheChain, and we always talk about how we use this for sentiment analysis. And actually, I get all my news stories these days just on TradeTheChain. There's a little button here on the right. It's not popping up right now because I'm compressed. But all the different news stories comes up. And every news story that I have right here is all taken from TradeTheChain. So if you want to take a look at this, there's a link in the description and check that out on top of the 1 hour projected ranges. I like these because you can see what could potentially go up in the next hour. And you know, they got a 90% accuracy rating from the tie. So yeah, check it out. That's it. But let's just get into the big stories, because this, to me, I feel is enormous. So Binance Coin, or Binance, excuse me, launches Cardano and Cosmos. What's going on here? Well, you can see it right here. This is it. Cardano, you're going to be able to stake at almost 22%. 22%. I can't make that up. That's crazy. Atom at 25%. I always thought Atom wasn't really doing too much. I didn't really, you know, see it. I know it's interoperability, kind of like what we have with Polkadot. So good for that. But it looks like they're making some grounds. And if it's good enough for Binance to go, you know what, let's stake this and let's give you this much yield for staking, that's pretty amazing. Now, let's get into it, though, because it's not just about just staking. So it's a locked staking service. So it's not like with Cardano is much different for staking as opposed to Ethereum. In Ethereum, you have to lock it up, and it could be for 6 months, a year, 2 years. There's really no really set date on that one. And if you lock it up and the provider has some kind of issues with it not being up in time, you could have your rewards slashed. Or not even slash rewards, you can have your Ethereum taken away as a penalty. Not the whole thing, but you can have parts of it taken away. So it's one of the reasons why I did not stake my Ethereum, even though the yield's pretty good. The yield's like 9%, something like that. It's pretty great. But Cardano is totally different. When you stake with a Cardano pool operator, you can put it into that staking pool. You can take it out immediately. You can leave it in for as long as you want to. You get rewards paid out every 5 days, and you can do whatever you want to it. So there's no lockup period or anything like that. The difference is that with that one, you get 4-6%. So you're probably like, well, why did I do that? I get this 21%, genius. Hold on. So it's a period of 15 days the lock staking service we offer for a period of 15 days with a maximum amount of 1,000 ADA and 50 Atom. So you can only stake right now 1,000 ADA, and that is it. So, I mean, if you've been here for a while, some of you guys got like a ton of ADA, and that's not too much. But hey, 1,000 ADA over there, not too bad, 22%. Lock it up for 15 days and off you go. Further, annualized interest rates will be almost 22%. So great. Cardano stake pools currently offer a little over 5% delegation rewards. Actually, the average is between 4 and 6%. In fact, earlier this year, Celsius Network had also announced that it would be adding ADA to its list of assets in Q2 of 2021. On top of that, Celsius has also said that they are going to be taking their Celsius token and putting it onto the Cardano blockchain. So they are moving away from Ethereum. And then on top of this, just so you know, we here at DNews, our digital asset news, have a staking pool called DNews. And there is a link in the description. It's one of the very first ones after the description of the actual video, which will take you to our webpage where you can find all about it. And then if you just click on here, because it's compressed, click on wallets, it'll just scroll down, or you can scroll on yourself. Watch this 13-minute video. We explain exactly what we are, what we do, and how we guarantee rewards, because we use the Microsoft Azure network, one of the most trusted, also one of the most expensive to actually use. And we've been having a return on ADA, a return on ad spend, or return on ad spend, return on spend of ADA, almost 5.46%. So we're in the upper threshold of that. So if you have an ADA to stake, that would be fantastic. Take a look at that. But to get back here, so not only did we talk about this piece here, Cardano's going into Africa. Charles Hoskins is talking about, he's very bullish on decentralized finance and Africa and the nations. We talked at length about this one, but this one caught me for a loop because it says Grayscale recently incorporated 5 new trusts for cryptocurrency assets. I believe Theta is one of them. According to a Delaware corporate registry filing on 27 January, Cosmos and Cardano were part of these new trusts, suggesting that Grayscale might be gearing up for some new product launches in the near future. So isn't that interesting? So Cosmos and Cardano were part of Grayscale. Binance comes in here, says, you know what? We want to do Atom and Cardano. And then you've got Celsius Network going, you know what? We're going to switch to Cardano. And do you see the theme that just keeps going on here? It's the same thing over and over again. It's Cardano, Cardano, Cardano. And this is one of those projects that is, it's a really a slow burner. And it's taken a while, but here we are. And it's absolutely blasted off. So I think 2021 is going to be a pretty great year. But the real question that I have is, first of all, is Binance. How are they going to be able to do this? How are they going to be able to give you almost 22% for staking? I think if it's just like Celsius, where they're going to be able to, I mean, they say you're going to be locking up. Maybe they're going to lock up themselves, or maybe they're going to be doing some type of interest yield bearing with loans. Maybe they do what Celsius does, is they loan out your cryptocurrency, and then you have all these different hedge funds and institutions making money off it in one of three ways. Either they're shorting it, there is a market, they're becoming the market maker, or there's an arbitrage opportunity. It's one of those three things, kind of like all the time. So I don't know exactly what that is, if they're really locking up for 15 days, or if it's just like, well, we're just going to keep it here. That's that's for Binance to distinguish. I don't think anybody really cares they're going to get 22%. You know, for annual return. And the only bummer of this is that you can only do 1,000. So let me know what you think in the comment section, and then let's move on to our next piece. So next up, this I thought for sure would be the most bearish article I would have read today, but it's the exact opposite. And Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis is looking at DeFi. What do they say? Well, on a February 5th report titled Decentralized Finance on Blockchain and Smart Contract-Based Financial Markets comes with warnings about smart contract security, scalability, and other risk factors, but it's otherwise bullish. And if you've been around for a while, you remember the whole thing with the Sushi Swap and the Master Chef and all these different DeFi products that have fallen out of favor. Yearn Finances has had their issues as well, the flash loan crashes and things like that. So DeFi sounds fantastic until it's not. And then you have these instances of where DeFi could be just, it could be a monster. But the thing is, there has to be so many things worked out before that happens. And in that time, a lot of people are going to lose a lot of money. Now, do I think it's a good investment? Yeah, I do. Because I personally have Aave. I think it's a great project. You can look into Compound. Synthetix is next on my list to actually scoop up. Especially for the derivatives market. But I mean, in the beginning, it's just going to be a rocky road, but that's what we're here for, right? We're not here for to be that stable. There's a lot of opportunities out there and we have to take risks. Anyhow, DeFi offers exciting opportunities and has the potential to create a truly open, transparent, and immutable financial infrastructure, wrote Fabian Schar. Who's that? Well, Schar, he writes for the St. Louis Fed. He is part of the Fed. He is a professor, one of the different colleges. Where is he at? University of Basel professor, specializes in DLT, or distributed ledger technologies. So what he talks about, he goes, look, at the beginning of last year, there was less than $1 billion of value locked in the DeFi protocols. But over this year, there's $38 billion. So you got a 38X in a very short amount of time. Growth was spurred by major events, one of those being the Uniswap drop. And I remember when Uniswap, if you weren't around, it was pretty great because all you had to do was just use Uniswap once. And they, you know, they had your information as far as your wallet. And they would say, hey, thanks for using Uniswap. Here's 400 Uniswap tokens. And at the time, it was like only $4. So you're like, wow, I just got $1,600. And some subscribers had told me that, yeah, they had used multiple wallets. They had signed up multiple times. One person had 4 different wallets. So they had to do some quick math, 1,600 unis. And that's at $4 a piece. And now Uniswap is right around $20. So not too shabby, I would say. But I remember when people were talking about Uniswap, like, I should just get rid of it, it's going to be worthless. I'm like, no. I mean, that's how you treat a community. If you do great things like that and you just give a token worth, you know, real monetary value, not some S token that just has nothing to do with anything. That's huge. And I said right then, I will not sell this token. I still have the original 400 Uniswap tokens. I've actually added more. Anyhow, Char noted four ways in which the DeFi ecosystem may benefit financial infrastructure: accessibility, composability, efficiency, and transparency. Of course, we all know about transparency, but composability and accessibility, what's this? So he talks about accessibility. He goes, the infrastructure requirements are low and the risk of discrimination is almost inexistent due to lack of identities, which makes a lot of sense, right? If you don't know the person, no one's filling out an application, you don't have to look at a background, you're just like, well, here you go, this is what it is. Then there really is no discrimination anywhere across the board. So that is a good thing. I never really thought about that. Second, the technology allows quick transfers of tokens using smart contracts. Game changer, right? Because with banks, they suck. It takes a lot of days to settle and is expensive. So if you just have a smart contract, like here's a prime example. Have you ever bought a house or whatever, you know, investment properties? It's a pain in the A because like you have to sit down, you have to go to the mortgage broker, go down there and go, okay, well, here's a little paperwork. Let me send it off to this person. They'll have it signed, this and back and forth. Before you know it, you have all these origination fees. You're like, what the heck is this all about? Why is this so hard? And then all the way through the recording fees. So I look at all that and I'm like, there's no reason for you guys to really do this, especially with what's going on with DeFi. So that's what makes me excited about DeFi in that regard. Just eliminating the middleman. Anyhow, transparency, the availability of historical and current data is a vast improvement over traditional financial systems, and it can help cut off potential financial disasters before they occur. So when I was reading this, I got confused because I'm like, is this really the Federal Reserve of St. Louis talking about, you know, we want more transparency? I was like, really? But I mean, if they want it, sure, I guess. But who knows? Maybe it's they're playing 3D chess with us. I don't know. But I mean, think about it this way. If you had a Bernie Madoff Ponzi scheme, right? And you could just take a look at everybody could look at all the books that were open and they could take a look at all the transactions. They would have seen that this was a huge Ponzi scheme and a lot of people wouldn't have lost so much money. So I think in that regard, yeah, I can definitely see that. But again, when I'm looking at this, I'm like, really? The St. Louis Reserve? But okay. And then lastly, he talks about composability, the ability to create multiple products and fuse them together, something new, allows for expanding range of possibilities, which is true. Like what we just talked about, you know, with like mortgages, with like futures. I mean, just eliminating the middle person and just getting a heck of a lot more done with a lot less expense. So again, I think DeFi will be big, and there's a lot of other YouTubers that are bigger into DeFi than me. Elio Trades is one of them. That guy's always talking about DeFi. So if you want to check him out, he's got some great stuff on what's going on and what is the next thing. To me, I kind of look at DeFi as like, it's like the ICOs of 2017, but more legitimate because there's going to be a lot of DeFi projects, just like there's a lot of ICOs, but a lot of them are not going to make it. And only the strong will survive, but we'll see. Anyhow, that's it for that. Let me know what you think of the comments section. Let's move on to our last piece. So last up, this is very quickly. Elon Musk tweets about Dogecoin, and Dogecoin goes up. That's it. So this was a tweet. He goes, hey, I bought some Dogecoin for little X so we can be a toddler hodler. Pretty funny. Dogecoin's price started to climb 1 minute after Musk's Twitter post and topped 8 cents before pairing the gains. So if you were holding Doge, congratulations. I had some old bags of Doge I had totally forgot about in my Nano Ledger, and I sold it all when it hit like 6 or 7 cents. I was like, this is not, I don't think it's going to go up to a dollar. Sorry if you think it is. I just don't think it is. I could be wrong. I'm wrong all the time, but I got rid of it. And it's just an interesting thing. Like exactly what I say, I do still believe that news moves the market. When you have some kind of major listing, it'll move the market. We just saw what happened with Cardano, moves the market. Atom, I'm sure that's up as well. And then again, Trade the Chain is where I find all the news. And that's, there's a button right here I click and then off. And that's what I found, that Dogecoin thing. I'm like, oh, that's interesting. So anyhow, so that's it for today. Hey, if you made all the way, thanks for watching all the way to the end. I appreciate it. If you liked the video, give it a thumbs up. And then also consider subscribing, because all these things we talk about are pretty time sensitive. And then that is all for today. If you like these types of videos, I'm going to put two more up on the left and right. I don't know. YouTube do its magic, all that stuff. And that is it. So I will see you tonight for the live stream. We're going to go over four portfolios. I'm just going to talk about, you know, what I would do. And then also what the outcome could potentially be based on my price predictions for 2021. All right, that's it. I'll see you on the next one tonight.